We are here today to talk to you about bad games. There is a cottage industry in going on YouTube, like the Angry Video Game Nerd is probably the best example of this, and talking about this Doom clone. Games that, for example, when I was young, I saw this somewhere and I didn't remember where, and until the internet existed, I didn't think that was real. I did not know that that actually existed.
I knew the CDI was a thing because I saw it in like a department store in the electronics section. But
you hear rumors like, oh, there's a Zelda game where you can play a Zelda. I was like, bullshit. There's no such thing. Shaq Fu, which,
You guys are expecting us to talk about all kinds of bad games like the ones we have showed you.
Yep, for example, one of the most disastrous game releases of all time, but not the most famous bad game of all time. I think you can all anticipate what the most famous bad game of all time is.
Every time anything about E.T. ever appears, all I can think is that time in Spanish class and they made us watch E.T. in Spanish. It was all E.T. Telefono La Casa.
E.T. is a perfectly good game. In fact, E.T. is way above average for an Atari 2600 game. It is way above average for any entertainment medium that wasn't a movie or a book or a play or music that came out in the year that that game came out. And yet everyone shits all over E.T. Everyone talks about how bad E.T. is like the default, oh, at least it's not E.T. The Angry Video Game Nerd made a movie, and the entire movie's premise was that E.T. is a bad game. What about Yars' Revenge?
Yars' Revenge is like a ridiculously famous game, and it's heralded as like one of the best games on Atari ever. Oh my god, Yars' Revenge, that's an Atari classic. You gotta play this. Oh, it's so awesome. Who knows how to play Yars' Revenge? Anybody?
Yeah, not many. Yeah. So, E.T., what do? You collect all the pieces of the phone, and then you phone home, and that's it. And it's really straightforward. In Yars' Revenge, you think you shoot that thing? You don't shoot that thing. Shooting that thing doesn't do anything. What's this thing in the middle do? Fuck you. So, why does everyone hate E.T., or at least claim to hate E.T.? How many of you have actually played E.T.? Wow, a lot of shade being thrown at E.T. for people who have never actually played it.
Yeah, when I was a kid, I mean, there were some people who had Ataris and had E.T. I had an Atari, we didn't have E.T. though. It was like the only people who didn't buy that game. And, you know, kids played it, and we didn't think there was anything wrong with it. It wasn't until years and years later, the internet age, when people started, you know, I started seeing all the hate for E.T. come out, like around the college times. You know, and it's like, where did all this hate come from? It was because emulators and whatnot, people were able to go back and play this old game, not having played it in its original time, plus the legend of, you know, the graveyard, yeah,
yep.
Right? That legend combined with people having played it, you know, way past the time it came out, you know, created this sort of mystique of E.T. is so bad, oh my god.
I mean, we're pretty old. Now, a few people in the room are like, really, really, you fucking kids? But yeah, we're pretty old. And when we used to buy video games, you'd come home, you'd sit in your parents' car, and you'd read the instruction book. The really long, really thick instruction book that came with the game. I mean, look, it says, start with game 3. This is what this is. Find the piece. It tells you how to play the game. Atari games were incomprehensible without these books. But you kids today, when you play E.T., you turn on the emulator, you start playing. There's no, like, Mega Man to tell you what to do. So why is E.T. so hated? Why is E.T. so remembered as being the worst game ever?
Well, I mean, it's not only the aforementioned reasons of, you know, it being, you know, the landfill, right? It's also the fact that they promoted this so much, more than any other Atari game had ever been promoted.
I think they actually printed more copies of this game, the cartridge, than there were Atari consoles in houses.
Right, but it's like, we look today at like AAA games, you know, when they're marketing giant booths at conventions, which I guess video game conventions didn't exist then, right? But, you know, ads in magazines, ads on TV, even before movies. E.T. was like the first game that had some giant marketing campaign. And while the game isn't as bad as the legend foretells, right, it's still not great. You know, it's really hard to control E.T. getting out of the, you know, the holes in the ground, and then you fall right back in.
Yeah. Though there is a fan project a while ago. You can look for this online, but a dude took E.T., the game code, and rewrote it so it would still run on an Atari, but he fixed all the problems with the game. And that kind of code, like, he had to, like, take pixels away from the characters to use them to do things in other parts of the game.
Yeah, he needed to have enough memory. The cartridge was full, so he had to, you know, optimize.
Yep, so E.T. wasn't really worse than other games that came out at the time. It just... It failed at something. It failed at something very specific. It failed at being the blockbuster. It failed at being E.T. the movie. It failed at being literally the greatest gaming experience that the media has ever told you you will ever have in your life.
And it failed at being better than the other Atari games you already owned, like Combat or
yep.
Outlaw.
So, the thing you have to remember, what we're going to talk about for the next 54 minutes, is that no game is bad. You can't just say a game is bad. Games are bad at something. It's so weird with the projector over there, because every time I change the slide, I see everyone go, So if you're going to shit all over someone's game, you can't just say a game is bad. You have to be able to articulate exactly what it is bad at.
Right, because even a really, really bad game like the ones we showed at the beginning, like Superman 64, well, yeah, it's a bad game, all right, sure, whatever. But it's good at something. It's good at frustrating someone who's playing it.
It's good at being a lesson why you shouldn't ship a game early even when the producer tells you to.
It's good at being material to make fun of YouTube videos.
Yeah.
It has a lot of good uses, that game, right? It's not completely 100% bad.
So, we're going to go through a series of games and talk about them. Now, the first game we're going to talk about is Candyland. Candyland is bad at being a game.
If you remember how to play Candyland from your childhood, you would remember that in the course of playing this game, you make no actual decisions at any point. Right? There is no reason to actually play the Candyland. You can just flip over the cards and look at them and then say, Rimwin.
Now, it is a game. We see, you know, we kind of joke, but it is a game. No one's going to say Candyland is not a game. Yet, you don't take any action. So you could argue maybe that it isn't a game. So it's bad at being a competitive game, an ortho game, a ranking game, a test of skill game. It's bad at all that. It teaches kids how to count.
It teaches kids colors.
It's family board game time. I mean, Candyland and that kind of board game time is how I kind of got into games.
It has really awesome characters, like Queen Frostine, who was the bomb.
I mean, look at this fake picture. Like, those people look like they're really having fun, obviously.
Oh, snap, gooey gumdrops!
Monopoly.
Monopoly is a game. Unlike Candyland, you make decisions in Monopoly. But they don't really matter all that much at all.
Yeah. If you know, if you're an adult and you can count, Monopoly is pretty much just a random game. Monopoly is bad at ending.
See, because, yeah, the perfect sport on Earth is tennis. Tennis is like the perfect game just all across the board. In a game of tennis, if you're still playing tennis, you still have a chance to win. Match point, I could still win, theoretically. As soon as it's over and you cannot possibly win, you stop playing at that moment. In Monopoly, it's over way before it's over. You know who's already won, but if they want to actually win, they're going to have to sit there for 2 more hours, and that's a big problem.
Which is my strategy, because if I'm hanging on to spinning around, hanging out in jail for 3 hours, and Scott gets so fed up that he leaves, I win. So Monopoly is bad for all these reasons. Monopoly doesn't actually end when it should end, so people have fond memories of playing Monopoly, and then they go back and try to play it, and it takes forever, and they quit, or flip the table over, or whatever it is. So Monopoly, what's it good at? Why do people still talk about Monopoly? Why does everyone still play Monopoly? Why do we keep forgetting?
Well, the theme of Monopoly is really cool. I actually like the iron and the dog and the car. And
I think they changed them all now. You're old. It's all different stuff.
They ruined it.
Monopoly
taught me... Forget nothing good about Monopoly.
As a kid, Monopoly taught me math. Monopoly taught me that games can be solved. Monopoly was the point, and a lot of you might experience this, when you play family board game night and all your things, and then you'd start to win because you figured out how to play Monopoly, and then suddenly Dad and your little brother don't want to play anymore. Monopoly teaches you that games can reward you for skill. Monopoly teaches you all this stuff, and everyone learns Monopoly from their parents. You didn't read the rule book. If you read the rule book, you'd know that free parking doesn't do anything.
Monopoly also has other social uses, right? Pretty much anyone you meet that's in the United States, at least, knows how to play Monopoly, or kind of mostly knows enough that you could bust it out and play it. So if there's ever some sort of social situation where a board game is appropriate and the people aren't necessarily open to Catan or whatever, you can, Monopoly will get the job done.
Long shot. So if you listen to us at this point, you know, we kind of crapped on Monopoly because, you know, it doesn't really have a good skill input. It's not really, like, you can't say, I'm better than you at Monopoly because I win Monopoly. I'm better than you at wasting my time. Long shot is a completely random game. You're just betting on horses.
Right.
Just bet on horses.
You just don't need to use actual horses.
You're just like, come on, Herbert Derp, come on. Nuts to
know. Right. So when you play, someone busted this game out at a party, and we're like, what is this? Just betting on horses? Is this going to be exciting? Yeah, it was crazy exciting. Right? Ponies were in season, so like My Little Pony just came out, so we're like, come on, Rainbow Dash, let's go. give names to all these guys, right? And all you do is literally bet on the horses. So it's not really a good game because, like, you make decisions, but they don't matter, right? That horse could just pull from the rear all the way to the front where the other horse is not even moving. So you don't have anything to know what to bet on. You just sort of bet and cheer.
So it's a game that's bad at ranking players. It's bad at testing skills. It's good at being super fun late at night, a little drunk. Dungeons and Dragons. If you're interested in what we're about to say, we have two versions of a lecture we call Beyond Dungeons and Dragons. So we've done it many Penny Arcade Expos in the past. I love Dungeons and Dragons. Dungeons and Dragons, however...
No, you don't.
I do love
Dungeons. You love it so much. When was the last time you played it?
Dungeons and Dragons taught me that role-playing games exist. Dungeons and Dragons was a formative part of the first decade and a half of my sentient childhood. Dungeons and Dragons I have many fond memories of. But it is a terrible system to use to role-play.
If you ever look... Yeah, okay. If you look at the... You know, just to summarize some of the things we say in the other panel, right? If you look at the character sheet of Dungeons & Dragons... I don't know about 5th edition. I haven't played that, right? But I'm pretty sure it holds true there. Highlight all the parts of the character sheet that have to do with fighting. And see how much of the sheet is covered in highlighter. Pretty much the whole sheet. Dungeons & Dragons is a turn-based fantasy combat simulator. And all it has in the instruction book that has to do with role-playing is like one sentence that says, oh, by the way, you should probably role-play.
It's right? A really simple framework, and you can use it to, you know, have a role-playing game and resolve conflicts and push your story forward, but it really only excels if you're telling the exact kind of story that it wants to tell, which is basically World of Warcraft Raid.
Right. So if you want to actually role-play and tell stories... Do not use this. Go and find...
Unless our story is, we're going into a dungeon and we're attacking a bunch of monsters and then we're going to overcome a challenge to slay the dragon.
Sure. That's a boring story. Have you ever liked that story?
I've liked that story on occasion.
Yeah, okay. There are many, many thousands of RPGs, indie RPGs out there, just like indie video games, that each one is tailored to a specific story. So figure out the kind of story that you want to tell with your friends and then go and find the game that tells that story and play that.
Yep, I mean, if you want elven court drama, this game does not give you a lot to make that elven court drama happen. Cards Against Humanity. So, Apples to Apples was sort of the first iteration of this in popular gamer culture. And Apples to Apples was a broken game because it was fun until everyone had a hand of the names of celebrities they didn't recognize.
And if you played them, it's like, well, no one knows that celebrity is, so you don't get a point.
And you usually played Apples to Apples either late at night at a convention or with your family. And the only time you actually had fun is when someone put out the one really inappropriate answer.
Right. Well, in some ways, Apples to Apples was more clever than Cards Against Humanity because it would be just as dirty, but it would always have to use innuendo because the cards literally were so clean. Cards Against Humanity was like, we're throwing out that innuendo. So my first reaction to seeing Cards Against Humanity was like, okay, so it's intentionally dirty apples to apples, they're just going all explicit, and I was like, there's no way that can be, like, as funny, because they're not being all intelligent and subtle with their, you know, dirty humor. They're just coming out with it. But no, it's way more funny than apples to apples.
Yeah. So we're not saying it's bad as a game. I mean, I've had a lot of fun with Cards Against Humanity. It is a big part of our convention culture. It's bad at being a game that you should play more than once or twice a year. If you play this game at every PAX, you're going to be really bored with this game in a couple of years. If you play this game when you're not at a PAX, you're going to hate this game.
I think there was a PAX when it was really hot. We played it maybe 3 times. We were playing it in the Omegathon line, where you all should be. I don't know why you still haven't listened to me. And, you know, then it was, like, still funny, but most of the cards was like, all right, seen this card before. And, you know... Dead babies isn't funny the 100th time, or even the 3rd time, right?
But you're implying that the 2nd time it was hilarious.
Sure, yeah, it was. All right, so you have to keep buying expansions, but even then, even if you get the expansion in there, how often are you going to draw the expansion card? How often is it actually going to be funny?
So it's a good game that very rapidly becomes a bad game if you play it a lot. It's a game that's very bad at being a game that you continue to own. Yahtzee. Has anyone played Yahtzee?
Okay, wow. All right, good. Most conventions we go to, people don't know how to play Yahtzee, and that's really a big problem.
Yahtzee is a competitive test of skill. Yahtzee is a straightforward skill game. Yahtzee is completely random if you're smart.
All right, so the thing with Yahtzee, like many games, is people argue like it's a skill game, and it is, because if I have more skills than you at Yahtzee, I am very likely to win. But once everyone knows how to play Yahtzee properly and has the same level of skill, you can't really get better. There's a skill cap. as a point at which a human being can easily, if you are reasonably intelligent, play Yahtzee perfectly, and then, at that point, the winner will be determined by the rolling of the dice. Right? So me and Rym, if we play Yahtzee, it's going to be like one out of two who wins, because dice.
Yeah, well, we did, there was
but
that
if
website.
I play with some little kid who can't even add, I'm probably going to beat them every time.
There was that website where you play Yahtzee, and it compares every action you take to a perfect bot that would play Yahtzee. And then it tells you how statistically perfectly you play Yahtzee. We're like 98%, like we're good.
Everyone we tried was like 98% perfect at Yahtzee.
So Yahtzee is a great game to get good at games. Everyone who goes to a PAX and plays tabletop games should be able to just do Yahtzee-type games basically perfectly. You know how to make combos and do your stuff, figure out the risk-reward ratio of going for the Yahtzee or not, or giving up on chance. So Yahtzee is good at that. It's a game that's really good and becomes bad once you're smart. A few people aren't laughing. I feel like they're not good at Yahtzee. I guess we messed up the panel. I got the wrong slide here. So
there
soccer.
It is. Soccer is bad because diving.
Soccer
That's
is a
the
game. Soccer or football is a game where in the high levels of play, a very small number of points determines the game. 1-0 is a common score. So the value of a point is extreme. Simultaneously, it's extremely hard to score points, but the easiest way to score a point is on a penalty kick.
If you look statistically, like an absurd number of goals in very important soccer games are on penalty kicks. It's actually quite rare to just score just while playing soccer normally, right? And a lot of those scores that aren't on a penalty kick are because the other team had a red card and they were missing a player or something like that. You know, or some very important player was injured. Yeah. Not to say there is no skill in soccer. If you look statistically, like Ronaldo, you know, the best soccer player to exist on Earth right now. If you look, yeah, he scores a ton of goals, right? It's not just like a feeling you have in what. No, mathematically, he is way, way better than anyone else. But diving matters a ton in soccer. If you can convince the referee to give your team a penalty kick because you faked hurting your leg, acting skill can matter just as much as kicking skill.
No, simultaneously. Because the officiating is very soft. Soccer is very much against using like instant replays and technology.
Yeah, it's a miracle they finally put a thing in the ball so they know when it goes over the line. Oh my God.
So look at the opposite example, ice hockey. I don't know how popular ice hockey is down here. Ice hockey.
They got the Dallas Stars. They got two.
Oh yeah, Stars. Respectable team. Respectable team. So
still below the
in ice hockey, there are people at the central office of the NHL watching games. And if there's a problem with the refs don't know. Like,
if a goal needs to be reviewed in the NHL, there is one room where they are watching video of every hockey game all the time live, and they review it. Not the ref at the site, not whatever. They review everything that needs to be reviewed. The same people. It's totally perfect. You know, there's a little bit of subjectiveness in penalties and whatever. But you know what? If you look statistically, power play goals aren't even nearly close to as significant as penalty shots in soccer.
The reason for that is a game design reason, because soccer is soft officiating. The punishment for your average attempt to dive is practically zero. So diving is like the optimal strategy, because it's like, if it gives you a penalty kick, game over, man. So meanwhile, in hockey, sure, there's soft officiating in the penalties. There's so many penalties, and they're kind of split 50-50 between both teams that it all sort of evens out.
Also, a penalty shot is very rare in hockey. Most often, you just get a power play, which is a very short amount of time. You know, they don't just get to shoot on the goal, right?
Yeah.
You have to actually play hockey, and you can defend. Plus, if you are on the power play, right, if you're penalty killing, you can just ice the puck. So you, like, you get this extra defensive boost to counterattack the fact that you're a man down.
So the rules of soccer push the game toward diving being a legitimate and powerful strategy.
If you remove that from soccer, soccer would be an amazing game. Absolutely amazing.
So I'm gonna be real here. I hope no one in the room is a race walker. And I know there was a PAX keynote where you're not supposed to shit on anyone else's joy. I'm gonna shit all over race walking.
And it deserves it.
Race walking is a sport.
Technically.
Where you walk as fast as possible. And by walking, the rules are that you have to keep your front leg straight, and at least one foot has to be touching the ground at any given point. So
that's the difference between, you know, like a horse. A horse has like a gallop and a tree. You know about horses in Texas, right? Yeah. So horses have different gaits. A human has different gaits too. Yeah. We have walking, skipping, jogging, running, just like, you know, a horse, right?
Yep.
So all of them except for walking involve at some point during the leg motion, both feet being off the ground at the same time. When you skip, you have a little jump. When you jog, you sort of have that moment where you switch legs, and there's a time period in there where both legs are. When you run, you're basically jumping forward, right, with each step. Only with walking are both feet always on the ground at all times, or at least one of the two is on the ground at all times.
So, and people might have already noticed this, what's going on here?
What is going on there?
Zoom and enhance. That is the picture on Wikipedia about race walking. It turns out that everyone cheats at race walking.
Because if you truly walk and keep at least one foot on the ground at all times, there's a limit to how fast you can go, obviously.
You can calculate it by the length of your legs.
So race walking without cheating would simply be a leg measuring contest who has the longest leg.
We can do that a little bit faster with a tape measure.
We can indeed. I mean, so, you might get tired if the race walk is really long. Okay.
It is actually pretty tiring.
Sure.
To be fair.
It is.
But
depending on if it's marathon length.
The rules of race walking, we talk about bad officiating in soccer. Soccer is fine compared to this. The judges are not allowed to bend over to look more closely. The judges are not allowed to use cameras. They're not allowed to use mirrors. They're not allowed to use binoculars. And they have to, go talk to each other and use this flag system to even detect that someone's cheating and report it up and disqualify someone.
And if a cheating person crosses the finish line before the judges take action, they win. You can't do anything about it. So if you're near the finish line of a race walk, just freaking sprint. What are they gonna do?
Race walking is an Olympic sport. Settlers of Catan. I don't think I ever need to play Settlers of Catan again.
Not in my entire life.
Remember Yahtzee? Well, it turns out that all games, no matter what kind of game it is, either are in one class of the very test of a physical skill, physical ability.
Like a sport, like Counter-Strike, or
yeah.
Race walking. No, not race walking, football.
But all games, they're either random, arbitrary, which is effectively the same as random, or they're mathematically solvable. Chess will not likely be solved anytime soon because the math is hard. Checkers was solved many years ago. Mathematically proven to be a draw no matter what if people are good.
Thank you, Canada.
Two-player limit hold'em poker was solved recently.
Like a few weeks ago.
All games are mathematically solvable.
Solvable doesn't mean practically solvable, right? It might be such a complex game like chess that, yeah, okay, it is solvable, but no computer we own is going to do it until we invent the quantum computer very soon. But you can be done, right? You could theoretically make a computer that would win at chess no matter what, or at least do as good at chess as is possible no matter what.
And that already exists for this one variant of poker, and it already exists for a whole ton of games out there.
Like Yahtzee, or Connect Four, or Tic-Tac-Toe.
Yep. And the kinds of games that you play, like Settlers of Catan, it is still solvable. If you play Settlers, it feels like it's a really skill-based game, just like Yahtzee. But if you play this game a bunch, and you pay attention to it, and you start to really care about games and be good at them, Settlers, I'm confident that we can play Settlers perfectly, and the only thing that matters is the dice.
Right, so we've been to a few Settlers tournaments in our day, and you know, in the early rounds of a Settlers tournament, much like the early rounds of a Yahtzee tournament, right, the people who are better at Settlers will win, and the people who aren't any good will lose. When you get to the late rounds, everyone knows how to play the game really, really well. So what ends up happening is the winner is determined by the roll of the dice. Oh, a two got rolled, and I happen to have a settlement there, so I got some extra resources, and that tilted the tide, right? In that final round of a Settlers tournament, look online for, Settlers championship tournaments. That final game, it will be 9-9-9-10, the winner will have 10, and every single other player will have been able to get 10 if they got to their turn. Almost every time it ends like that.
So, Settlers is still a great game. I mean, we played Settlers for 5 or 6 years on a regular basis.
Right. This game is good at being the intro to high-quality board games. It is bad at being the long-lasting, continue-to-play-it-forever German board game.
Now, Yahtzee, subtly different is the teaching game. Yahtzee teaches you this really core basic skills. Settlers teaches you holistic skills. Being able to play Settlers really well means that you have a really big advantage in every other tabletop game out there. Settlers is a good game for that, but it is a game that if you play a lot of tabletop games, you will never want to play Settlers again, unless you're teaching a child. Silver Surfer. This game is just a test of skill. I mean, if you lose Silver Surfer, it's because you just suck.
It's the same exact... The bad guys are in the same place every time. The controls are the same every time. Nothing changes. Right? You can memorize it. You can get better at it. You can beat it. It's your fault if the Silver Surfer has to cry, even though he sort of has the power cosmic and can't die, but he does.
Well, somehow ghosts can just kind of come over here and take him out.
Yeah, even though, like, ridiculous cosmic beings can't. It doesn't make a lot of sense. But yeah, so this game is really bad. The reason it's really bad, not only because it doesn't make sense, is because if the Silver Surfer, in all his great cosmic power, if his surfboard touches and grazes one pixel of a rock, he dies.
The game is capricious. The game is arbitrary. The game, you can be good at it. You can watch some awesome games done quick, probably, of someone just, like, blasting through this game, not even looking at the screen, just, like, talking about, like, oh, yeah, this pattern,
yeah.
I memorized it, I'll do a blindfold, whatever. But it's not satisfying to get good at this game, because the game doesn't feel fair, because while it is, you can't perceive that. Those pixel borders, that collision and everything, they don't really line up. Meanwhile, a game like Super Meat Boy, you feel deep in your heart when you die that it was your fault and your fault alone.
Silver Surfer and Super Meat Boy are not really that different a game. Super Meat Boy is actually more evil. The pixels are smaller. There's more of them. And yes, you still die if you touch even one of them. Right? The difference is in Super Meat Boy, the pixels are absolutely clear. You can 100% see that, yup, Meat Boy's little arm touched that giant spinning chainsaw. Right? The Silver Surfer, he'll die from a ghost. He'd be like, that ghost tail didn't touch me. Right? Because the hitboxes are all messed up. Right? And in that way, Super Meat Boy feels like hard but fair. Like you won't be super angry throwing your controller unless you have anger issues. Silver Surfer, you're not going to get past screen one.
Now, there's another thing here. There's the idea of, like, if you beat a game, you get a reward. Like, you feel good about it. The game rewards you in some fashion. When you lose, you're sort of punished. You're set back. If you fail at a game a whole bunch and then succeed, the difference between your top and your bottom is how good you feel. Beating a hard game feels better than beating an easy game. But this game is so hard that you'll bottom out. You'll just give up. Super Meat Boy gets around that by rewarding you in a unique way. What happens? Every time you die, it remembers that path you took. So if you put 1,000 Meat Boys into something, you don't want to give that up. You want to see those 1,000 Meat Boys all go through the level at once and coalesce into the one motherfucker who made it. That is why I will play Super Meat Boy until 4 in the morning, because I've got to finish this map. But Silver Surfer I gave up on after I rented a Blockbuster, and I actually brought it back a day early.
Great music, though.
Really good music.
Yeah, great music.
Go!
Remember when we talked about how all games can be theoretically solved?
It is arguable that Go is solvable. Go is definitely solvable.
Oh,
however, by brute force alone, Go is so many more orders of magnitude complex than chess that chess will not likely be solved by brute force in the lifetime of anyone in this room, and Go may not be solvable in the projected lifespan of the universe.
You might need to create a computer that is, in fact, the size of an entire universe in order to solve Go.
By brute force alone, at least.
All right, you would need to do some sort of, you know, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy level stuff, where you use the entire universe as a computer in order to calculate the solution to Go.
Go is a game with a fantastic history. It is a great game. I'm not trying to say Go's a bad game, except this is the bad games panel, and I'm about to say it's a bad game. Go does a shit job of teaching you how to play it. Go gives no heuristics. It gives you no directional heuristic. You've got a piece down. How do you decide where to put the next piece? Some Go expert says, yeah, you should do that. And you start to just learn over time.
You can put a piece in Go anywhere on your turn, at any of the vertices. Should you put it out in the middle of nowhere? Should it put near the existing pieces? If you put it near the existing pieces, where? Right? You can put it, literally any move is open to you. So how do you know if you're doing a good move or a bad move? Usually, most games, video or otherwise, sort of give you some sort of hint, like, oh, you lost victory points doing that. Oh, you gained victory points doing that. Oh, you did that? Here's a bunch of money. Oh, I guess that was a good move. In Go, you put a stone on the board. And then 10 turns later, all your stones are off the board. You're like, how did that happen? Where did I go wrong 20 turns ago?
But simultaneously, look at a game like Settlers. Even though Settlers is reasonably complex, I mean, humans can't just run this full state of the game in their brain 100% with, like, all the odds and everything at once. But when you're playing Settlers, you at least intuitively have some basic heuristics, like building settlements gets me points. Scott has more settlements than me. He's doing better than me. That guy's one road away from Longest Road. He's got two soft points hanging out in there.
I did this thing, and I just got a whole bunch more resource cards. That was a good move.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go doesn't give you any of that. Go gives you no human intelligible feedback unless you dedicate your life to it.
Yeah, people who are good at Go, usually what they do is they study books. There are books that tell you how to be good at Go, and they memorize patterns. And they can't memorize the whole thing, obviously, but they can memorize areas. So it's like they'll see something happening somewhere on the board, they'll remember the book that had that pattern and what they're supposed to do about it, and then in that area, they will make that move that they remember from the book.
So two good Go players is like two good Street Fighter players. They are working on this higher level where I start pattern A, and this other guy like responds to his other's pattern, and oh, that was a bluff, and it's really crazy.
Right.
But to us, who don't play Go a lot, we look at it, and it makes no sense to us. We can't even understand the level they're working at. Go, you basically, it's bad at letting you play other games. Because you have to play just Go to get to that point. You have to play just Street Fighter to get to that point. I don't have time for that. Mario Kart.
Much like Mario Kart. Yeah, much like Mario Kart.
You want
El Toro Rosso again? Yeah, okay. Much like Go, Mario Kart is bad at heuristics. Now, wait a minute. Mario Kart gives you heuristics right there. You spin out, you know you did something wrong. You're in first place, which it just tells you, you know you're doing something good. Well, that is true, but at the same time, Mario Kart lies.
Who's in first place? It's not the guy in first place. It's the guy in second place because of the blue shell.
If the guy in second place is actually pretty close to the guy in first place, the blue shell might hit both of those guys. And third place is actually first place.
So Mario Kart is a game that is super fun to play because it sort of evens out all the skill. I mean, Mario Kart's a great game. But if you want to have a competition, like you want to say, I am better at a racing game than you, and you leave the items on, Mario Kart really feels bad for the people who are actually good at Mario Kart. And the worst Mario Kart player in your friend group will often win because everyone else attacks each other constantly. He has the blue shell, and then he gets the lightning bolt, and then he just blasts past at the end on Rainbow Road, whatever.
If you want to play Mario Kart where driving skill actually matters, there is the Mario Kart that is least appreciated, which is Mario Kart Super Circuit for the GBA. People do not remember this game because it was GBA Mario Kart, obviously, and most of the maps are just from the SNES one. But in GBA Mario Kart, if you drive perfectly, 100% perfectly, you drift around every corner, you never touch the brakes, you make every jump, you never touch the wall, you never go off-road, and the blue shell or red shell is fired, it will hover behind your ass, and it will not touch you. As long as you continue to drive absolutely 100% perfectly. And if you continue to do so either to the end of the race or long enough, it will eventually just give up and say, all right, fuck it. And because of that, I win a lot of Mario Kart Super Circuit almost all the time, and I hardly ever win any other Mario Kart.
Mario Kart is bad at getting your friends who are good at Mario Kart to actually want to play it with you. So, Mall of Horror. There's a lot of board games like this. Tons of board games like this. In fact, arguably, every board game that has more than two players or more than two teams and allows player interaction is the same as this game because this game is highly political. Political is a term you can steal from a Richard Garfield's book, Characteristics of Games. The idea is that in Mall of Horror, you basically go into rooms and then you vote someone out of the room. They get eaten by zombies.
Yeah, the zombie's outside, so it's like you're in the security zone and you're like, all right, we're holed up in this office, but in order to escape this room, we're going to need to feed someone to the zombies and run past. Who's it going to be? But there's more than two people, so you vote on all the people in the room vote, and then they send someone out.
So these games can all be boiled down to something called the balloon popping game. So you have a bunch of people. We won't try to play it interactively here. Sometimes we do that. Say you have four people, and everyone has three balloons. On your turn, pick one person and pop their balloon. The last person with balloons wins. That means the person who is least hated by everyone else in the room is the one who's going to win.
It's a vote who wins game. And this is the vote who wins game. So is Risk. It's the vote who wins game.
Yep. It doesn't matter how well you attack. The math of when you should attack and when you don't attack in Risk is solved. Risk is mostly a solved game. Risk is a terrible game. But if you attack someone, you can think of your score as I have plus one and Scott has minus one because I attacked Scott. If my friend Pete then attacks Scott, Scott's at minus two. Me and Pete are now doing better.
Right, so him and Pete both attack me. They pop two of my balloons. I'm down to one balloon. I'm going to lose. Not because I'm better or worse at Risk than they are, because they pop my balloons.
Because there's nothing...
Vote who wins game.
There's very rarely in all these political games where there's more than two players, one person's not winning. They're already mathematically eliminated. It doesn't matter. But they still have to play the game. They're going to get in your way. They're going to take that worker slot that you needed in Lords of Waterdeep. They're going to hit you with that green shell. They're going to attack you because they don't want you to win. They're going to lose a game.
Right.
For Rym.
Like I did yesterday. Or 2 days ago. Yeah, think about it. If Pete and Rym both pop my balloons, now I have no chance of winning, but I still have to play. I can basically decide who wins. I'm still playing. I can still pop balloons, right? But I'm losing. So I'm going to pop Rym's balloons. Pete wins. I just decide Pete won. Why? Because I said so.
Yep. All games that aren't two players or two teams where players interact are political games in some level. This will happen. You've seen it happen. Mull of Horror is a bad game because it's so pure that it is literally just an iterative popularity contest.
At least Riz tries to cover it up.
Counter-Strike is one of my favorite games, and it's just a head-clicking simulator. Heuristic 1. You want to be good at Counter-Strike? Heuristic 1. Play it for 20 years. Heuristic 2. Heuristic
be young.
Seven.
So
be
start
young.
When you're 3 so you can be good at 23.
Your reaction times peak 22, 23 is all downhill from there. Math, like, that's true. You're screwed.
Yep.
Number 3, memorize every map 100%. Memorize your corners. Where exactly should you point the crosshair? Everywhere you go in every map. And 4, just be able to flick and click on heads.
If you do those things, you can be pro Counter-Strike and make money.
If you like clicking on heads, Counter-Strike's a great game.
It's amazing.
If you don't have time for that shit, Counter-Strike is a terrible game.
Or if you're old.
So Team Fortress 2 solves all those problems. Counter-Strike has a really high skill cap. You have to, it's like Go, but on a smaller scale. You have to dedicate yourself to Counter-Strike. The FPS is to be good at it.
Once you are good at Counter-Strike, if you have a whole team of people who can click on heads, what separates them? Everyone's good at clicking on heads. Everyone knows the map. Everyone's young. So what happens? The winner is determined by teamworks and strategies and those sorts of things.
Yeah, oh, we went left. They went right. We covered bombsite B. They went to bombsite A. I threw the smoke. We had a cool strategy. It was all fun. For most pub games, especially just playing with random people on the internet, if one guy's just better at clicking on heads, he just walks around like Neo, just popping everyone with his CZ, whatever.
No
matter.
Amount of teamwork can stop someone who can actually click on heads if you cannot also click on heads.
So Team Fortress 2 kind of made baby mode Team Fortress. They pulled the
baby
FPS skill cap. Baby mode FPS.
Yeah.
They pulled the skill cap way down. You can be a perfect sniper. You can play this game perfectly as a person.
Everyone's moving really slow. All the character models are really big. All the weapons are really inaccurate.
Small numbers of weapons, small numbers of options in the players, cooldown times, limited ammo. The game made sure that even if I am the god of Team Fortress 2, if my team is uncoordinated, we'll lose. I don't have that much personal input into the game.
No matter how well you can click on heads, it's not going to matter that much. You can get a random crit on someone and you'll die. Oh, it happens.
That makes it a great game for anyone who doesn't want to spend their entire life being good at Counter-Strike and regular Team Fortress.
Or anyone who's really old.
Yeah.
Can't click on heads anymore.
Because suddenly, because we pulled the skill cap of that one piece down, all the other pieces get visible. The tide came down, you see all the gold hanging out there. Suddenly, the strategy that the Counter-Strike people do of two people go this way, one person go this way, faint with the decoy grenade, come back around, all that fun stuff, everybody can do that in Team Fortress. Everybody. It's a bad game for people like me who remember games like this. Team Fortress 2 is the sequel to Team Fortress Classic, which is the sequel to Team Fortress, Mega Team Fortress. The peak complexity and the peak skill cap of all those games was a game called Weapons Factory. It was a mod for Quake 2. It's like Team Fortress. Has anyone played Weapons Factory? Anyone in this room?
Those two people laughed over there.
So imagine if Team Fortress 2 were 40 times faster. If the character models were 10 times smaller. If the maps were 10 times bigger. If everyone had a grappling hook and could move around in three dimensions all the time like crazy. If every character had like 9 fucking weapons and they were all way different. The Marine can throw a turret and he's got like 2 different kinds of rocket launchers and another weird grenade.
And to use all these weapons, you have to write in the Quake scripting language in your terminal to configure buttons for all of them.
Yeah, Quake 1 had offhand grenades. Hit a button, grenade pops out. Quake 2 did not have that. Anyone who's good at this game wrote a script with wait statements that would switch weapons, throw a grenade, switch back. And if you didn't do that, you could not play pro.
A pretty good player at this game would be able to throw a grenade such that it would land on your feet, bouncing you into the air where you would come in contact with the grenade they shot before they came in the room.
This game was so complex, and the individual skill cap was so high, that back when I was a young man and I would actually do stuff like this, if I played on a pubby here, it'd be like a recon, I would just fly around the ceiling with a grappling hook and everything, going crazy, just like killing people, no one could stop me, I was the invincible Neo. one dude could carry an entire team regardless of strategy if he was just that good. However, much like Go, no one has time to learn a game like that. This game is not fun for anyone who isn't a ridiculous nerd. So this is a better game for 80, 90% of humans. This is a better game for crazy people, and this is a better game for old crazy people.
But for the reasons we just explained, you're never going to see Team Fortress 2 taken seriously as an esport, right? Because there's no sport in it. It's down to, you know, non-sport activities.
Yep. I mean, if you want to learn Team Fortress 2, just start playing. You'll figure it out. Learn the script.
To start.
So Tribes 2.
The greatest game that has ever existed.
I don't know how many of you have played Tribes 2. I'm just really curious.
Oh, good. Whoa. We got some awesome people in this room.
Tribes
yeah.
2. You know, we're at the Penny Arcade Expo, right? Until recently, like the last few several years, Tribes 2 was talked about a lot on Penny Arcade.
There are many, many Penny Arcade comics about this game that is completely forgotten by most people.
I don't think you understand how important to gamers Tribes 2 was when it was out. No game has ever really been like Tribes 2. I don't want to get into all the details about why this game was amazing, but nothing else has ever been like it. Tribes 2, however, back when Penny Arcade did the Weird Ride Awards, won the saddest award ever. Best game until they fucked it up.
Tribes 2, one of the things it had was a forum built into the game. So every player in the game had a forum account. It wasn't like the Counter-Strike forum where you had to be dedicated and go seek it out on the web. All right? The official forum was built into the game, so everyone could easily go in there and
post. You had your own tribe's email address in the game just to talk about the game.
Yeah, it was amazing. So people went in there and they said the things that you should change about tribes.
You should add
players know what's best to do in a game, right? They know how to design
make
games.
Make skiing easier. Make the weapons bigger. Make
me
more
automatically enter a vehicle when I buy it, so I can't buy one for my friend to get in. So what happened is they fucked it up.
They did a lot of those things. The community was saying, hey, make changes. And they actually paid attention to what the community wanted. And it turns out that most people who are in the gaming community are not game designers. Tribes 2 eventually fractured into a million different servers, every one of which was running some bullshit mod that broke the game and you didn't really know how it worked. No one playtested this stuff. And then simultaneously, the game had DRM. It relied on central servers. Yeah, those servers are gone. Long gone.
There are some ways to play it, but it's with great difficulty.
Do you want to play this game today? Download an EXE file from a dude. I swear it's legit. Tribes 2 was bad at continuing to exist. Adventure games are just movies. You click and the movie keeps going. I love adventure games. I loved that game. But you just click to see more of Star Wars.
Imagine if you were watching Lord of the Rings in the movie theater and every 5 minutes it stopped and it said, here's a trivia question. If you choose right, we'll show you more of the movie. If not, we'll show you like a 5-second clip and then you'll have to start from the beginning. Or at least come back to this trivia question.
Now, there are adventure games that had branching stories. Decisions mattered, or they'd punish you in some way, you'd die, the world would change and all that, but most adventure games were pretty much just click until you succeed, maybe it makes you restart because you died, or maybe it just says some funny joke. They're games, we're not saying they're not games, but they're not ortho games, they're not skill games, you're not going to do a competitive speed run of this. I kind of want to see that.
Maybe you could, yeah.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah, no, AGDQ, get on that.
They're not IDEO games, they're not like a series of interesting decisions, because the decisions aren't pushing the game a different direction. If you fail to solve a puzzle, it's the same as Mario falling in the pit. So there's no skill and there's no branching, it's just a movie. It's an interactive experience. It's a hilarious interactive experience, it's an amazing interactive experience, but it's just an interactive experience.
Watching an adventure game on YouTube is 99% as good as playing it yourself, right?
In fact, I'd recommend if you want to pirate old adventure games, watch walkthroughs, watch Let's Plays. That's the same as playing them.
Almost the same.
Almost the same. Pandemic is an awful goddamn game.
This game is garbage. I'm not even going to hold back. Pandemic is completely awful. So on the surface, Pandemic is supposed to be this co-op game where you work together with your friends to sort of save the world from the horrible virus. In reality, it's a solitaire game. One person saves the world from a horrible virus.
One person
among your friends who is best at Pandemic.
Pandemic is bad at being a cooperative game.
The thing that it's trying to be.
Because the rules are set up such that it's a cooperative game, not game theory cooperative, which is an entirely different kind of game. But like, me and Scott, we're trying to beat the board together. because of the way the game works, there's no real communication rules, or other games like Shadows over Camelot, similar game, Battlestar Galactica, same problem.
Same problem.
Those games give these soft bullshit rules, like, you can't say the card you got in your hand, but you can kind of wink and nod and nudge, like, I'm feeling good, I'm feeling too good about this hand right now.
Yeah, yeah, I'm feeling, yeah. I'm feeling pretty blue.
Oh,
I'm
also,
my hand.
I'm also feeling blue, I'm really sad. I'm too sad. Sad equals blue. I have two blue cards.
Right? So, I mean, that's the one thing that's supposed to keep you from sort of just turning into a solitaire game is it's hidden information, but they don't actually prevent you from sharing it. And it ends up just being solitaire.
The other way to do that is what the new XCOM game does. We played it at the last PAX, where there's a time limit. There's a computer saying,
Space Alert does the same
go,
thing.
Go, 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 Rym, you've got 8 resources. Spend them now. Oh, too late. Fuck you. It's gone. Now the aliens are coming. What do you do? Like,
yeah, you don't have time to talk with your friend and be like, yeah, three resource aliens killed you. What?
You know how XCOM works? I was the, like, CEO, whatever, so I'm doling out money, right? The money I pass around doesn't mean anything. Scott says, I need 4 money. I say, you get 3. Deal with it. And then
if I spend the 4 money, it's spent.
He can spend it.
And then at the end of the round, that money tokens that he's using, those are just helpful. They're not the real deal. You calculate at the end of the round how much money you spent, and if you went over budget.
Oh, Scott spent more money than he said he did because he was in a hurry, didn't listen to Rym. Oh, yeah, you guys are fucked now.
The other game that solves this problem perfectly is Spiel des Jahres winning Hanabi, the greatest co-op game to ever exist.
Hanabi.
It means fireworks in Japanese. The way Hanabi works, if you haven't played it, is everyone gets a hand of cards. And you are simply trying to play the cards in order in the different colors. Like 1 red, 1 green, 2 red, 1 blue. And there's 5 colors, and you're just trying to count to 5 in each color.
You
really
hold your hand facing all the other players. You never see your own hand.
You may not look at the own cards in your own hand, but you have to play them.
And the game has very strict rules. On your turn, you either play a card, sight unseen, throw away a card, sight unseen, or spend a token to tell someone one of 2 things about their hand.
Rym, you have 3 blue cards.
3 blue cards.
All right.
Why would Scott have told me that? So, Scott, you have 1 red card.
Oh, I do.
That one.
All right. It's my turn again?
Yep.
I'm going to play this red card that I haven't seen ever in my life and hope it's the next one we need to play.
See what happened there?
Screwed.
Why would I tell Scott about that fucking red card right then and there unless I had some reason for it? That game is a true cooperative game. You're all trying to read each other's minds, and the rules are very explicit. You can say the number or the color of a set of cards someone has, and that's it.
Right.
And it costs an action.
And you can't conceal, right? So Rym had 3 blue cards. I can't be like, you have 1 blue card when he has 3.
Scott wants to play this one. He can't say, you have 1 blue card.
Because he has 3. I have to say all 3. I can't be like, yeah, that one. If he has 3 ones and I wanted to play one of them, I just got to be like, well, you have 3 ones.
Hanabi and XCOM are the only good cooperative tabletop games I've ever seen.
Space Alert's okay.
Space Alert's pretty good.
The problem with Space Alert is you need to be much smarter. Everyone needs to know how to program a computer.
Fine. Hanabi and XCOM are the only great co-op games I've ever seen.
Okay, sure.
Pandemic literally just becomes one guy knows what's going on. And so if the person who's good like says, oh, do that, what are you going to do? Are you going to say, no, man, I'm doing something different so
I'm
we gonna
make us
lose.
I'm going to do a worse move because I want to do my own turn.
There's a little bit of we're old men who are not good at RTSs baked in here. MOBAs, well, it depends. There's a lot of things wrong with MOBAs. MOBAs have the go problem. They don't give good feedback because...
At least the ones that are out now.
Yeah, most of the MOBAs that are out today, it's very difficult to learn how to play them without reading guides that fans wrote explaining the math or having someone who knows what they're doing sitting down and literally teaching you, walk here, do this, stand exactly there for 5 minutes, then back up and stand exactly here for 5 minutes. If you fuck
this
up,
magic
we're root, you from
this
the
magic rune reappears every exactly this many seconds, so every that many seconds you have to go over and take a look and see which one it is and make sure there's no one else trying to get it.
Yup. Mm. So they're great games. If you learn them, they don't teach you how to play them, they hide the information you need to get good at them, and because they're competitive, they're ranked, there's leaderboards, if you fuck up at all, you get kicked, you're gone. Those of you who play MOBAs, if someone on your team is just feeding, how bad do you feel? How do you feel about them as a person?
And often, and the games that try to punish you for leaving, like in Dota, it's like, well, I can't kick them, because I'll get in trouble for that, for, you know, but what am I supposed to do? Just stay here and lose until we're done? It's like...
I'll just rage quit.
Yeah.
That's fine.
You know, it punishes you for that, too. So it basically forces you to sit there and suffer through the rest of a bad game.
MOBAs are bad at getting new people to play them who don't have a tune.
Yet somehow they have the most... They somehow have the most players of, like, any game. Somehow. It's some kind of miracle.
Quite a reaction from the crowd here on this one. MOBAs are bad at something else. This might sound kind of off-key here. MOBAs are bad at being spectator sports. Despite being the biggest spectator sport in all of gaming right now. Oh, well, I guess football is gaming.
Sure.
Yeah, hockey is gaming.
Right.
MOBAs are bad at being spectator sports unless you know how they work. If I watch a MOBA that I've never played and the crowd starts cheering... And usually, like, nothing happened on the screen. I can't tell what's going on. They're only great spectator sports if someone next to you is like, yeah, fuck yeah, and then they explain what happened. So it's the same thing.
We were at the big League of Legends area at PAX Prime, and there's, you know, big game going on, whatever. Everyone's watching it. And you saw some crazy stuff happen on the screen, and some people cheered, like, yay, and there's a delay where a whole bunch of other people cheered. Right? You go to a football game, you ever see a touchdown where, like, three people are like, yes, and then everyone else is like, oh, it was like, okay. No, people know it's a touchdown. They can tell.
But
right?
Football has that, too. Like, say, I don't know about football, and Scott does. We're sitting here, and, like, they're setting up for an onside kick. Like, something weird's about to happen in football. And I don't know
what's
going
on. You would know until they kicked it.
Yeah, but, like, you suspect. Like, you suspect.
Unless
they really suck. Like, you suspect. Like, this is the situation. They might do the crazy thing. Something cool is going to happen. So the expert football person is going to be like, hey, something cool might happen. They might start explaining, like, why this thing's exciting. It's the same thing with MOBAs. MOBAs are only exciting to people who don't play them when they're watching them if someone else is pumping them up and telling them what's going on and getting them going. The breakout for esports is going to be the accessible spectator game.
Come on, Heroes of the Storm, don't suck. Please.
Doesn't have to be accessible to players.
Please don't suck.
It only has to be accessible to spectators. So story time, right?
Story time. Have I ever told you, no I haven't, about the Vanilla Coke? We were at, isn't the Vanilla Coke in the next line?
So. I was going to save that for the end. There was a game store. There was a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament. The game store owned a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh! Cards.
This was in early days of Yu-Gi-Oh! Relatively speaking in the U.S., like 2000, 2001. There weren't that many Yu-Gi-Oh! Cards. The store owned every Yu-Gi-Oh! Card there was to own because it was a game store.
So some people got together, some friends of ours, and they borrowed the best possible deck from the game store.
They made the best, most expensive, amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Deck you could possibly conceivably make, and they entered it into the tournament.
And they got our champion here to play the deck.
There was no player at all. The cards played themselves. They set up some sort of rule structure, like every turn it will draw, and then it will play a card if it can play
it. It'll play like each card if it can play it going this direction in its deck, and like it's really simple.
Yeah, they
rules.
Set up a little simple rule set for how it would play, and the Vanilla Coke just obeyed that rule set and played that very expensive Yu-Gi-Oh! Deck and came in second place.
I hope I don't need to tell you why pay-to-win games are a bad idea. Because ostensibly you're playing a game for some enjoyment, but is it enjoyable to lose because you didn't spend enough money?
The grand champion of Yu-Gi-Oh! Is Bill Gates. The grand champion of Magic the Gathering might be Bill Gates.
Well, but look at how Magic the Gathering fixed that. Yes, you can collect Magic cards. You can play in those kind of tournaments. Most people play drafts. Mm-hmm. Most people play the formats that remove the money factor because they know the money factor is bullshit.
There's also a bit of rock, paper, scissors. You might bring really expensive deck A if someone brings really expensive deck B and you lose to it. That kind of thing goes on.
So there's another kind of free-to-play game, somewhat topical here. I'm going to be blunt. These games are bad at being ethical. That's how I want to describe it because these games... And if you saw this South Park, if you didn't, you should watch it. They just trick you into having just enough fun to keep playing. These games are fucking bad, and you should not play them. These are the games that people play. I've seen studies. People play these kinds of games more often when they're depressed, when they have psychological issues, when things are going on. These games suck the life out of you. And they're designed to. Borderlands.
Now, Borderlands is quite similar, in fact, to many of these pay-to-win games. It's just instead of paying with money, you pay with time. Right? oh, I'm not gonna get all my Farmville farm way boosted up by paying money. I'm gonna get my Borderlands gear boosted up by sitting around shooting skull. What do they call Skags?
Skag Gulch.
Hanging out in Skag
Borderlands
Gulch for an hour. Yeah, that
was. Hang out in Skag Gulch.
Yeah,
I spent a lot of time in Skag Gulch. Yeah. Borderlands 1 was a perfect example of this because it had all the problems that MMOs, that stateful games have, in a game that didn't have to have those problems. I'd level up with Scott, and then I would play with my friend Phil. Oh, he's only level 4.
We both have to start over. Gotta go back to Skag Gulch again.
We gotta go level up again. Why couldn't I just make a character at the level I needed?
Who's that? Who's hurt by that? Who's hurt if they just let me make a character at any level I want to make a character at?
Because I'm just playing with my friends. There's no central server. It's not like I'm, like, doing the raid.
It's not like there's some world competition. Just let me choose my level. If you're going to have levels, just let me choose it. And then anyone can play with anyone at any time.
So these games have that feedback cycle with their loot. And simultaneously, they enforce the statefulness of an MMO without actually being an MMO. So they take all these things that could be good, mash them together, and then take all the bad baggage of all those things. You could have made a game, removed some baggage, and the game would have just objectively been better and have hurt no one.
If you ever played WarioWare for the GameCube, that is the greatest party game to ever exist, maybe. It's pretty close.
It's pretty good.
Right. You basically play the micro games, and you got the disco mode, the turtle mode, what was the other mode?
It is versus WarioWare. 4 players are all playing micro games alternatingly or at the same time, and it's crazy. Nintendo didn't seem to realize why that game was popular. Because WarioWare is a single-player experience.
They realized it was popular because they made another one.
Yeah.
But they didn't realize why.
They made the sequel on the Wii. The Wii had that controller. That could have been the holy grail of party games. There's no multiplayer in that game.
Well, there is, but it doesn't really count.
There is technically multiplayer in that game.
Yeah, you couldn't all use the Wiimote to play a thing at the same time. It was like one Wiimote and like passing it around.
Yep.
And the multiplayer modes in that were garbage.
This game was bad at being the sequel it should have been. There's another example of this, ActRaiser. ActRaiser on the SNES. It's Sim Medieval Town, Sim God, and it's side-scroller Go Fight. And you power up the side-scroller by playing God.
And ActRaiser 1 is a classic, all-time favorite game. Why? Because the town part. The town part was so amazing. No one cared about the side-scrolly sword part. That was the, like, oh, I have to play this in order to get to this next town. I wanted to do the town part. ActRaiser 2, no town part, just the sword part. Great.
These games, you're all playing this. You're all playing this. This game is the same as this game. We call them candy boxes. Go online, this is your homework, type candy box into Google, and play candy box. Every second, you get one candy. Just wait. Games where there is no incremental cost to taking an action are usually bad because you can just take an infinite number of those actions. Tie-in games.
So when you see a game that has a license, you know, usually a movie, a game, a TV show, the reason they went and paid for a license is because they don't think their game can hold up on its own. They think, you know, if we want to sell this thing, we're going to have to, you know, get Adventure Time fans to buy it. If this didn't have, you know, Finn and Jake on the cover, who would buy this game? If it was made up characters we just invented? Nobody, because it's a bad game.
All the Adventure Time games specifically are lazily and badly designed. The first 5 minutes seem well designed, and then the rest is just literal garbage. These games are awful. Unequivocally awful, and you can pretty much assume that any game that's based on some IP is gonna be awful because the exceptions, the internet will tell you about them. Everybody realized TIE Fighter was a good game pretty early on.
So yeah, if you see some licensed game, you should be highly skeptical. No matter how much you love that license, some guy came to me, he's like, you love Mega Man, right? This is a Mega Man board game, aren't you excited? I'm like, no, I am very not excited about that. That is going to be bad until proven otherwise.
We're running out of time, we gotta get to the point, so the controversial part of this panel we're going to skip. But Kickstarter tabletop games are almost always really bad. And the Omegathon also has some problems, even though you should be at it. But what's the point of this whole panel? If you're going to shit on someone's joy, if you're going to say that the game that your friend likes is a bad game, play the game, understand what the game is bad at, and then articulate that. Say why it's bad. Give them an hour-long talk about why it's bad. And keep calling them back when they keep hanging up on you.
If the only thing that you can say when you don't like this game your friend is playing is like, that game sucks, it's a waste of time, you shouldn't play it, then you really don't have anything, do you? Right? You saw how much info we had to lay down if we wanted to hate on a game. Right? I could go on all day about any of these games sucks. I could give you a 2-hour lecture on friggin' Simon's Quest. Right? But study you can't games. Do that, keep your mouth shut.
These games are bad, but they're not bad for the reasons that everyone says they're bad. They're bad for very specific mechanical reasons. I like these games, and you're probably going to say they're bad games. I'm not personally offended. If someone says a thing you like is bad and backs it up, you have to agree with them if they're right. I like a lot of bad games. It's okay to like a bad game. Don't flip out when someone says that your game is poorly designed.
A lot of people take things personally. They're like, if I say Adventure Link is bad, someone out there who really loves Adventure Link thinks that I'm saying, because that is bad, that they are bad because they like it. And that is not true. I like a lot of bad things as well, and if you say they are bad, I will say, yes, they are bad, but I like them because that is the person who I am, and I know that you do not think that I'm a bad person because I like this bad thing.
And last and not least, most importantly, if you like a game, like a candy box, and you can't articulate why you like it specifically, what's good about it? A lot of people were mad, like, oh, Pandemic's a bad game. What do you like about Pandemic, and how much fun do you actually have playing it? Think about that. If you can't say why a game you like is a good game, it's probably a bad game, and it's probably doing something to you. We are out of time, and PAX is over.
No!
If you have questions or you want to see videos of all our other talks about this stuff, grab one of these things and go to our YouTube channel. We will not be able to talk to you up at the front of the room because we do have to let the enforcers clear this out as quickly as possible. Also, as you can hear, I'm losing my voice rapidly.
El Toro Rosso is not as powerful as you thought.
And I highly suggest that you go and see if there's room in the Omegathon finale, because the Omegathon is a good game to watch.
Thanks, guys. I have to get my camera. It's gonna take more time for the button.